In 1878, coal miners in a mine near Bernissart, Belgium, struck gold. However, on closer inspection, this gold turned out to be fool's gold contained within large bones. Soon after realizing the importance of this find, the Royal Belgian Institute of Natural Sciences was notified. Louis de Pauw was sent out to dig up the remains, and would help recover about 37 to 38 individual fossils of prehistoric giants. If it wasn't for the difficult excavation conditions and the fragility of the bones, all of these individuals would have most probably been articulated and complete. Moreover, most preserved soft tissues, such as skin and even what may have been flesh imprints. The fossils were from a previously known group, the iguanodontids, and their discovery would change the view of these animals forever. Before paleontological gold was struck under Bernissart, dinosaurs were only known from mostly fragmentary remains, leading to their restoration as giant lizard-like animals as seen in the 1854 reconstruction at Crystal Palace Park. After assembling the massive bones in a chapel, the world's second mountain dinosaur skeleton was revealed to the public. This new iguanodontid reconstruction featured a much more slender bipedal animal, with a stance inspired by a kangaroo and cassowary. Furthermore, its horn was relocated to the hand of the animal. This reconstruction was revolutionary, even though it would not stand the test of time. All in all, about 37 to 38 specimens were recovered. Almost all of them were Iguanodon bernissartensis. However, between these, one was part of a separate genus, Dolodon. The excavations at Bernissart would end in 1881, due to a lack of money and space. Later attempts to reach the fossil-rich bone beds would end in failure, most notably those of the Germans during World War I. The Germans had to retreat before the iguanodons could be reached, and as they retreated, they flooded the mine. In 2003, the bone bed containing the iguanodons was reached during a boring campaign in the Bernissart area. Material from one of these cores contained a piece of bone, showing the abundance of fossils still out there. For a long time, Iguanodon was a sort of trash bin group. This means that the cladistics are still a mess. So note, what is about to come may change within a few years. McDonald 2012 suggested the following cladistics. Within the suborder Ornithopoda, the family Iguanodontidae, and the genus Iguanodon. Today, the genus Iguanodon contains two species, Iguanodon bernissartensis, found within the upper Barminian to Aptian rocks of Belgium, Germany, France, Spain, and Great Britain, and Iguanodon galvensis, from the lower Barminian of Spain. Interestingly, a study on individual variation within Iguanodon bernissartensis showed that several features used to identify iguanodon species with postcranial material varied more than previously thought. This might mean that the genus Delaparentia should no longer be valid, as the fossils fall within the individual variation of Iguanodon bernissartensis. Iguanodon bernissartensis was about 8 to 10 meters long, while Iguanodon galvensis was somewhat smaller. These animals are expected to have exhibited herding behavior due to the amount of animals found close together at Bernissart. Unlike the previous reconstructions, Iguanodon bernissartensis would probably have walked on all fours. However, it did have the possibility to walk bipedally if needed. Iguanodon had some strange forelimbs. These sported the now famous thumb claw as well as a prehensile pinky finger. The prehensile digit held onto plants while feeding. However, the use of the false thumb was less clear. Most famously is the theory it was used as a defensive weapon. However, as it seems obvious, this would have been highly improbable. The predator would have to come within biting distance, and the iguanodon would have to be quite accurate with its claws. Other theories are for display or interspecies fighting, or maybe a foraging function, by either breaking nuts off fruits or helping to strip leaves off of branches. The skull of Iguanodon sported a beak for snapping plant material. These plants would then be processed within the mouth with 200 plus leaf-shaped teeth, This compensated for the lack of horizontal jaw movement. Around the remains of Iguanodon, other organisms were found, representing the environment at the time. The relative abundance of ferns is typical for a Cretaceous swamp. This is in stark contrast to the surrounding areas, which were dominated by large conifer forests. The swamp was home to 15 species of fish, with 2,927 specimens described. A rare amphibian, insects, worms, and two species of crocodiliform, most notably the dwarf species Benisertia. Theories on how these animals were preserved together evolved over time. The earliest theory suggested that the iguanodons accumulated due to sudden flooding events, falling off cliffs, or other violent deaths. Later theories suggested that the animals got stuck in mud or died of old age, after which the bodies got covered with sediment and avoided erosion within the sinkhole. A clue to how they met their end are the opisthotonic poses of most dinosaurs found. This is the all-too-famous pose where the neck is flung back towards the body. These poses can be caused by brain asphyxiations resulting from drowning, asphyxiation, lack of nourishment, environmental toxins, or viral infections. Lastly, a lack of evidence for long-distance transport after death means that the animals died close or at the place of burial, and the preservation of soft tissues shows that the dinosaurs were quickly covered with sediment. Most iguanodon found are adults. This means that the age distribution reflects the actual age distribution expected in life, pointing to an unbiased cause of death. This leads to more recent theories, based on intoxication. Swamp gas, or H2S, together with CO2, are common products of organic matter decay. H2S can build up in swampy environments, and when released, can suffocate any animals in the area. H2S is formed by bacteria decomposing organic material in anaerobic conditions. The clays are rich in organic matter, and many sedimentological structures elude gas escape. Moreover, the preservation of soft tissue suggests that anaerobic conditions were present during burial. The Cretaceous clays cut through Pennsylvanian coal formations, which overlie the Mississippian limestone. Underneath this limestone formation, geothermal sulfate-rich brines are present. And these brines may be the source of more H2S. Sinkhole formation could have been accompanied by the uprising flow of deep brines and adjacent fractures and faults. This upwelling still happens today, as the mine had to employ several measures to reduce the H2S concentration, and deep sulfate-rich geothermal springs are still present in the surrounding area. Another form of intoxication is a biological intoxication. This could have been initiated by the same brines. The increasing temperature and influx of elements could have created unusual biological activity, for example, by creating cyanobacterial blooms in the water and sulfate-reducing bacteria blooms in sediments. Further evidence for these blooms may be the strong positive delta carbon 13 anomaly in the sedimentary organic matter within these clays, which may be interpreted as a boost of algal, bacterial, or macrophytal productivity. Finally, as the iguanodon stampeded through the area, their trampling would have increased the release of H2S. The release of gas would have either smothered them outright or made them pass out, thereby drowning them within the swamp. Intoxication could also explain why the fish bone bed underlies the iguanodon bone bed, as the animals living within the swamp would die off of swamp gas before any passing terrestrial animals. However, it is important to note that this hypothesis is not flawless. Most importantly, death by intoxication would also have affected other animals within the area. This is not reflected within the fossil record, as almost all dinosaurs found are Iguanodon benisertensis, except for one toe bone of a predatory dinosaur, and Dolodon. So why didn't other animals within the area suffer the same fate, and why are they so underrepresented? Hopefully, more recent developments will help unravel the remaining mystery surrounding the Iguanodon sinkhole.